Fine. All of you, please do this question quickly. You have, suppose, a string. At the end of the string, there is a mass M. The length of the string is L. Okay. You are pulling this mass with some force. And that, because of that, let's say the force is F. It always remains horizontal. Fine. So this bob moves a distance. It moves by an angle of theta as shown in the figure. Okay. The length is L. You need to find the change in gravitational potential energy. How much it is between this location, let's say this is location one and this is location two. Between these two locations, how much is the gravitational potential energy that has changed? Aware H1 and H2 are not given. See, you can assume this line to be zero gravitation potential energy. Fine. So once you assume that this line represents gravitation potential energy to be zero, then the potential energy of point two will be what? Suppose this is the height h. Potential energy of two will become equal to mg into h. Fine. And what is h? It is very similar to the previous one, where h will come out to be L minus L cos theta. Okay, so this is a right angle triangle. From here to here, this length is L cos theta. Okay, so U2 will come out to be mg L 1 minus cos theta. Fine. So U2 minus U1 will come out to be this only, because U1 you have assumed to be zero. Okay. Now, if you assume, let's say, this horizontal line to be zero, will delta U change? Will delta U, which is U2 minus U1, will it change or will it remain the same? I'm asking you, if you are changing the line for which gravitational potential energy is zero, will the change in potential energy vary or it remains the same? It remains the same, right? It's like this, you know, that you take a length, you take a scale, all right? So if this is 10 centimeter and this is 40 centimeter, you have a reading, it starts with 10 centimeter and ends at 40 centimeter. This length, which is difference between 40 and 10, will remain 30. Okay, it doesn't matter. You can take this as zero. If this is zero, if you take that to be zero, this could probably become 20. Fine. So 20 minus or minus 10, still it's 30. So length, which is the difference between the two readings, it remains the same. Fine. So you can assume any gravitation potential energy line to be zero, the change in potential energy remains the same. Fine. So that's the best part about it. You can choose gravitation potential energy to be zero at any location and you will be able to find same change in potential energy. All right. So I will now quickly talk about the implication of the potential energy. The last concept we have learned, that work done is equal to change in kinetic energy, right? This is the work energy theorem. Now you can modify this theorem by saying that work done can be work done by conservative force plus work done by non-conservative force, okay, plus work done by, let's say, other forces. Fine. And you can say this is equal to change in kinetic energy, K2 minus K1. Getting it, all of you? So I am modifying the work energy theorem only. So work done by conservative force, we have just discussed, work done by conservative force is negative of change in potential energy plus work done by conservative force plus other forces work done will be equal to change in kinetic energy. Fine. So if you modify this, you will get, okay, what is WO? WO is the work done by other forces. Like, you're not sure whether it is conservative or non-conservative. So you just, take it as other forces. This is non-conservative because work done by conservative force becomes change in potential energy. So this is non-conservative force. So work done by non-conservative force plus work done by other forces is equal to change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy. Okay. So if I club non-conservative forces and other forces together, so we can say that total work done by all the other forces, be it non-conservative or any other force, will be equal to change in kinetic energy, which is K2 minus K1, plus change in potential energy, which is U2 minus U1. Fine. So this entire thing gets modified into K2 plus U2 minus K1 plus U1. Fine. So this is another variation of work energy theorem. Here we are writing the, we are writing in terms of potential energy also. Till now, we never factored in the potential energy. We always used to take the work done by all the forces. Fine. Now, what we are doing? We are converting work done by conservative force, okay, in the form of potential energy. Fine. So, if you take potential energy of the gravity, then do not find out the work done by the gravity now. Are you getting it? So, if you are taking potential energy of any force, then you should not find out the work done by that force and put it on the left hand side. Fine. So these are the other forces other than for which you have considered the potential energy. Okay. Any doubts till now? Please text. No doubts. Okay. So we have modified our work energy theorem and now we have written like this. Guys, this is the equation which you have to use in every question of this chapter. Fine. So make sure you are familiar with this and you are able to use it freely. Okay. U2 is the final potential energy. K2 is the final kinetic energy. U1 is initial potential energy and K1 is initial kinetic energy. Fine. This potential energy and kinetic energy sum, that together they are called as mechanical energy. All right. Fine. And if only conservative forces are applied, if only conservative forces are applied on the system or mass, or non-conservative forces don't do any work, fine, then work done by other forces will become zero. This is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Fine. So you will get U2 plus K2 is equal to U1 plus K1. What is U2 plus K2? This is final mechanical energy. This is final mechanical energy, sum of kinetic energy and potential energy. And this is equal to initial mechanical energy. Fine. So mechanical energy will be conserved if there are only conservative force acting on a system, or let's say other forces are there, but they are not doing any work. Then the mechanical energy will be conserved. Okay. Now we have talked about the the gravitation potential energy, all right? Let's talk about quickly the spring potential energy also, because even this work done by the spring does not depend on the path, isn't it? We have already found out that work done by the spring is what? Work done by the spring is half kx1 square minus half kx2 square, right? So it doesn't matter how x1 has come and from x1 to x2, how you have gone. It only depends on x1 and x2, that is initial and final position, okay? And hence, you can define the potential energy for the spring force also, okay? So according to the definition, change in potential energy is equal to negative of the work done by the spring. Okay, so negative of the work done by the spring will give you half k x2 square minus half k x1 square. All right, okay. So this is the negative of the work done by the spring, and this should be equal to change in potential energy. So this is, let's say, u2 minus u1. Okay. Now let's say if x1 is 0, what does it mean? Initially, the spring in its natural length. Initially, the spring is in its natural length. Fine. So if x1 is 0, this term will become 0. So what do you get? U2 minus U1, you will get as half kx2 square. Fine. Now U1 is what? U1 is potential energy of the spring when extension or compression in the spring is 0. Fine. So if you assume that in such scenario, if potential energy when x is 0, if you assume that to be 0, okay, again we are assuming here something to be 0. Okay, so if you assume that spring has 0 potential energy when it is in its natural length, then the potential energy of the spring will become half k x square. Fine. So I can write down a generic thing. Potential energy is half k x square for a spring. Okay, and since it is a unique point where the spring is in natural length, then we are assuming potential energy to be, zero. And since it is present in all the spring will have a natural length, right? So we can all universally accept that, okay, let us call, potential energy of a spring to be zero when it is in its natural length. Fine. So we don't have to again and again find out or again and again have to assume when the potential energy of the spring will become zero. So everyone has accepted that they will say that when the spring is in its natural length, we'll all assume that potential energy of the spring is zero. Fine. Now the x can be compression and x could be extension. X can be anything. Fine. But it doesn't matter. The potential energy will be equal to half kx square. The spring potential energy will always be greater than zero. It can never be less than zero. Fine. This is something unique about the spring potential energy, which was not the case with gravitation potential energy, because gravitation potential energy can be negative. Getting it? So spring potential energy is half kx square, and hence the spring potential energy will always be greater than zero. Okay, all of you clear about this? Any doubt? Okay, that's great. Now let me tell you one thing where most of the students falter. See, potential energy due to spring at times is tricky. You need to look at initial compression or extension in the spring. Okay, this is something which many students ignore. Fine. So spring can be already compressed. So spring can have initial potential energy itself. Getting it? For example, if I have a spring like this, and on top of it, if there is a mass m, so spring is compressed, so it already has a potential energy initially. Okay, so there will be a lot of such scenarios. I have taken the most simple example to, you know, make you aware that potential energy need not be zero initially all the time. Fine. So be cautious with respect to this. See, now let us further look at our modified version of work energy theorem, work done by the other forces. What is other forces? Other forces are the forces for which you have not considered the potential energy. This is equal to this. Okay. Now this potential energy, it can be potential energy due to gravity and potential due to spring. Both can be present. Okay. So make sure you take care of both gravitation potential energy plus spring potential energy. All right. And usually you'll have friction as the force which is other than the force for which you are considering the potential energy. So this could be due to the friction. Could be. Fine. So any doubts till now? Anything? Message me. Any doubts? No doubts. Okay. So we are all good for taking few questions.